To follow on from our introduction in part one, in which we covered the core benefits of model-based systems engineering, we will now run over a key industry-based MBSE language, SysML. In this webinar, we will cover more applied MBSE by running over SysML examples. As stated earlier, there are other languages based around MBSE. However, SysML is considered exemplary in this field. As a structure for this webinar, we will look at what were termed the four pillars of SysML and expand on this to include other diagram types commonly used. Then in part three, we will run over the human as well as the computer interpretation of these models. As a general overview of SysML, it is expressed as having four pillars with the interoperability between these. These four pillars are structure, behavior, requirements, and parametrics. The general industry interpretation of these four specific modeling types is more focused on the intensity of usage rather than on any lineal time or staging view. So it does not incorporate other stage parts of the process like vision mission, domain model, analysis, and verification. However, for now, we will cover this from the four pillar SysML specification perspective. In this case, let's run over the HSUV example supplied with the OMG's SysML 1.6 specification, which is modeled in the EA example model supplied with Enterprise Architect. As a start of the process, we have some core requirement models, covering all the key points needed for the car design, all the way down to the fuel requirements. Then we have the structural models, the block definition diagrams, the internal block and constraint block diagrams. In this case, a block definition view of the power system fuel flow and its relation to the fuel tank assembly. Then we have the behavioral models, which includes activity, state machine, and interaction diagrams. In this case, we have an activity diagram looking at the power fuel flow in the car. And finally, we have the parametric diagrams that cover the interaction or mathematical formula and the parameters that feed it. So let's look at the requirements first. Although requirements are not the primary starting point of a model, these are crucial and play a key part in the higher level initiation of a large project. These are a high level of abstraction that lay out clear points covering the features that are to be constructed. We have here the reference to the specification and the various requirements derived from that. On any element, you can update the text and the ID in the fields. This diagram format provides a brief overview, but we can set the diagram format to show the text of each requirement. This includes text-based descriptions on each requirement and its identifier. For a more document-centric approach, we can set it to use the specification manager view. As stated earlier, these requirements can also include foundation requirements taken from specifications. In this case, we have some basic AutoSci requirements that will provide a foundation for the HSUV being modeled. They can also include requirements specific to your organization and to any core requirements for the domain that you're working on. We'll cover traceability of these requirements in part three. With the structural side of SysML, this includes the block definition, the internal block definition, and the constraint block diagrams. A block defines a collection of features used to describe a system, subsystem, component, or other engineering objects that are related to the scope of what is being designed. This includes blocks and part properties. The objects in these diagrams define what is to be used. This is distinct from how these are used as specific instances, which we will cover later in the internal block definition diagram, or IBD. The core points that blocks convey are structural composition, connectivity, and classification. Structural composition. The block definition diagram can be used to lay out the structural composition. For example, in the hybrid HSUV example supplied with the EA example model, we have the core structures including the power subsystem, the brake system, and the body system. With the connectivity, let's take a quick look at the traceability view for the power subsystem block. Here we see a variety of relationships, but core to this block definition, we have part associations. Underlying these are many others, as you can see via the traceability view of the power subsystem. This is just one on this plane, but there are hierarchical relationships down into the internal block diagrams or IBDs, which we will cover later. For classification, a block can be a specific case of a more abstract block. That is, it can be an inheritance of the core features of that abstraction. For instance, we see this case where a front wheel is derived from a wheel hub assembly classifier and has specific characteristics different to a rear wheel derived from the same block. The block definition diagrams and the internal block definition diagrams work complementary to one another, with the IBD showing the usage of the paths defined in the block definition diagram that encapsulates them. For example, with the block power subsystem breakdown, on double-clicking on this, we have the IBD CAN bus description. This includes parts derived from the blocks defined in the power system block definition diagram. For this, we have a core component, the controller area network, or in short CAN, which includes connectivity via ports for the electrical power controller, the transmission, the internal combustion engine, and a power control unit, all providing network interactions between these. So let's have a quick run through the creation process for an IBD covering some core connections to the CAN bus for our car. First, we create the IBD under the power subsystem. Then we create a part property from the CAN bus block. Then we create a part from the electrical power controller. On creating this, we select the all on the structural elements to ensure that all of its parts and properties are to be shown. In order to work on what ports are shown, we only want to show the flow ports. So we open the features window and select the ports and parts tab. Then we unselect the ports we don't want to show. We leave the flow port. For diagram clarity, we stop the stereotype being shown in this diagram. Then we give the electrical power controller part a short name identifier. Then we add in the transmission and set that to show only the flow ports. We also include the internal combustion engine and the power control unit. Then we connect each of these flow ports to the CAN bus. And that completes our IBD for the key parts interacting through the CAN bus, showing the usage of blocks, ports, and connectors. The constraint blocks are where we define the formula or equations behind the parts that will be used in the parametric models. In the example of the HSUV, we have a number of constraint definitions. This straight line vehicle dynamics is a specific group that is part of a broader group of constraints. These constraints contain equations that are used in the related parametric models. So let's have a look at creating a constraint block using the constraint wizard. From the HSUV specification, we are given a math formula from the fuel flow rate. We take that to create our constraint. We start in this new block definition diagram. Press the spacebar to create a new constraint block. This prompts us with the Edit Constraint Block wizard. We add the formula from the specification, and on exiting this field, we see the parameters defined below, which are derived from the formula. The types of each of these, in this case, happen to be real, but they can be easily altered. Note that the Edit Constraint Block option is accessible in the context menu. The parametric diagram is meant to enforce the rules that are defined in the constraint blocks, in particular for the mathematical equations that are to be used. Looking back at the block definition diagram covering the power system, we have a subsidiary block definition for the fuel flow definition. Related to this is the fuel flow constraint that we just created. We can see that these equations are used in the parametric diagram, which ties these mathematical rules using ports and binding connectors, in other words, keyword equals, between the constraint block equation and its parameters, with the part value properties on the parametric diagram. For a more complex example, we look at the straight line vehicle dynamics, again defined in the constraints and derived from the HSUV block definition diagram. Like the convenient tools to help you create constraint blocks, Enterprise Architect also provides a process to set up parametric diagrams by parsing mathematical equations to create parameter binding connectors. In this case, we create a new parametric diagram, name it, then drop on the constraint block that we just created, then give it an abbreviated name. Then, in the context menu, we select Edit Constraint Properties. This brings up the parameter binding window. Then we select what properties we want these to bind to. In this case, these are the parameters in the fuel block, which this diagram is a child of. That gives us this simple parametric diagram with bindings to cover the parameters used in the equation. In part 3, we will look at how these types of constraints and bindings are used in model simulations. Having had a brief run over the structural modeling, let's now have a look at the behavioral modeling side. The core set of UML behavioral model types can be applied in SysML. In the design process, these can start above the block definitions as more abstract models used in the analysis, like under use cases, or later, they can be more tightly included in the block and internal block diagrams, with specific details including port definitions. What is available are use case diagrams, activity diagrams, state machine diagrams, and interaction diagrams. As there are numerous videos covering the standard UML behavioral modeling, and given SysML behavioral modeling is derived from UML, we won't go too deeply into these. Let's start with a more abstract use case diagram. Although expressed in UML as behavioral diagrams, these are not considered Turing complete, so are not simulatable, but they are used on the abstract level for calling more complete behavioral models. Here we have a layout of the analysis of the user's interaction based on the requirements defined earlier. For example, in the operational use case diagram, we have the drive the vehicle use case, which includes accelerate, steer, and brake. It also has child diagrams, an interaction diagram, and a state machine. Both are not being defined under a block, and so are simply expressing the analysis worked through for these use cases. If we go into more tightly defined behavioral models that are children of blocks, such as state machines, activity, and sequence diagrams, we see a very different case. With SysML, these are defined under the blocks as own behaviors. Let's look at the function-based behavior of activity diagrams. With activity diagrams, we can use these to define block functions based as models under the blocks. In this case, we have an activity diagram as an aggregation of the power block in the HSUV. This is defining the human process of pushing the accelerator and the parallel process of provide power. With the provide power, this is passing the flow to use either the battery or for speed using the internal combustion engine, all based on the accelerator position and the vehicle mode preference to define which to use. We also see that it is defined as an aggregation of the power block. With a state machine defined under a block as an owned behavior, that state's operation, transition, guards and effects can reference the properties of the parent and determine the transition between the states based on these parameters. Let's look at an example that is modeling a humidifier's heat controller. This state machine is a simple continuous flow with the control status changing based on the values of the properties of the parent block, the heat control block. The interaction points, we can see, are defined in the features window. These properties are used in the transition guards, with a JavaScript condition determining the flow. This example uses SysFIS for defining simulator-specific values and can be simulated in both Modelica and MATLAB Simulink. When looking at examples of interaction diagrams, we go back to the HSUV model. We have some examples of sequence diagrams under the drive use case, where we have several interaction occurrence references, beginning with the start the vehicle black box, which is referencing a simple sequence diagram where we have a reference to the start vehicle white box. Each of these showing the interaction between parts that are derived from blocks in the model. In this last case, the electronic control unit, or ECU, enabling the electrical power controller. What is a fundamental underlying principle of engineering is the definition of units of measure and how these are defined and used consistently across a project. The SysML value type is used for defining a unit of measure, a quantity of kind, that is associated with a value or measure and provides the fundamental reference of quantity within the scope of the model. Here we have an example of this as defined in the HSUV model. This covers the core units of measure used throughout the model. To look at an example of the application of these, we see that in the fuel efficiency equation constraint block, we have values set with these. In this case, the wheel power is set to horsepower, which can be referenced from the element properties under type. Although we have covered some of the key diagram types based around the four pillars, there are other key overview diagrams like the domain model and the package diagram. The domain model clarifies the domain in which the model is working, defining a boundary to ensure there is no scope creep, ensuring external features are not included in the project. With the package diagram, the main elements shown in these are the set of core packages that represent a summary of the complete model. In this case, it includes the requirements package, the root of the structural package tree, and the behavioral model package tree. This usually includes a model library of commonly used objects, such as definitions and the value types, as outlined earlier. Before going on to look at other aspects of the human and computer interpretation of the modeling, let's do a brief summary of the points covered in the SysML presentation. In this, we have covered in detail the four pillars of SysML, including requirements, structural modeling, including block definition diagrams, internal block diagrams, constraint block diagrams, and parametric diagrams. Then we looked at behavioral model diagrams, including use case diagrams, activity diagrams, state machine diagrams, and interaction diagrams. In conclusion, hopefully part two of this series has given you a good overview of applying MBSE, along with some core detail of working with SysML for model-based systems engineering in Enterprise Architect. In part three, we will be looking at the human and computer interpretation of the modeling, including simulation and model-based code generation.